In this module 2, today we will cover some basic gray level transformations and also histogram processing. All the image processing techniques, they can be classified as the spatial domain or the transform domain. In the spatial domain, we are going to concentrate on the pixels of an image. The spatial domain techniques, they are going to operate directly on the pixels of an image, whereas in the frequency domain, we are going to operate on the Fourier transform of an image. In the spatial domain, we are going to act upon an image. Generally, the spatial domain techniques are more efficient because they are computationally very fast and they require less processing resources to implement. In the spatial domain, we are going to talk about two functions, that is g of xy and f of xy. F of xy is the input function, that is the input image. So we know that the images are nothing but the functions. So f of xy is an image. And for this, when I apply the transformation, now this will become the g of xy, that is output image. The output is also a function which is in terms of x and y. So the t here, it is nothing but the transformation or the operator what I am going to apply on the function f, and it is always defined over a neighborhood of the point xy, because we know that in the spatial domain we are always acting upon the pixels, that is nothing but the x and y values of the function, that is the function f of xy or the function g of xy. We are always acting upon the neighborhood, that means the pixels which are surrounding the concentrated pixel, that means what we are trying to modify the pixel xy, around that what are there, the neighborhood of this pixel, they will be mainly understood in the spatial domain, that means they will be processed in the spatial domain process. In the spatial domain, we always talk about a pixel and its neighbors. In this picture, you can see a 3x3 matrix where my pixel, which is I am talking about, that is called as xy, and its neighbors are given by the pixels surrounding it. So this process here, it is consisting of moving the origin of the neighborhood from pixel to pixel and applying the operator t to the pixels in the neighborhood to yield the output at that location. That means if I am having any pixel, that is xy, then its neighbor is given by 3x3, then the t is defined as computing the average intensity of the neighborhood. Say suppose I want to calculate the average intensity, and my arbitrary location, if it is 100, 150, that means x is equal to 100 and y is equal to 150, and this is the origin of the neighborhood. So we are going to compute the sum of all the 8 neighbors around this 100, 150, and then I am going to divide that by 9. So here we are going to compute the values based on the neighborhood. When the origin of the neighborhood is at the border of the image, then some of the image will be lying inside the image. I mean some of the part of the image will be lying inside the image. This procedure you can be ignoring, or you can go for specifying another transformation, and you can pad the image with the border of zeros, and then you can go to find what actually it is happening over here. So this type of processing is called as the spatial domain. In the spatial domain, we are going to concentrate on a pixel and its neighbors. A intensity transformation function can be given as S is equal to T of R, where S and R are the variables which are denoting the intensity of the G and F. That means we know that G and F are the output and the input functions. So at any point xy, with the intensity of g and f, it is given by the values of s and r. So in the figure you can see here, the first one, it is having the form where the effect of applying a transformation to every pixel of f, here it is going to generate the corresponding pixels in g, and it is going to produce an image where this image will be of higher contrast than the original by darkening the intensity levels below k, and brightening the levels above K. That means you can look at the picture over here in the figure A. So we have a curve here. So the value, what is there? What all the value? It is having the intensity level below K, they will be darkened. So whatever is below K, they will be darkened. And whatever is above K, so you're going to get a brightened value. So this is possible, and this process is called as a contrast stretching. And you can see in the figure B what is going to happen. Here, the T of R, it is going to produce a two-level image. And this is having a thresholding value. That means from where you were having, suppose if the up till the K, you have one value. And from after K, you have the next value. That means here you are having two stages. That means you are going to get two values. Depending upon a threshold value, that means one particular value we will take, and we'll take that to be as a thresholding value. So based on the thresholding value, you can get two different values here. Whereas in the first case, you are having a variations. It was not only two values, it can be more than two values also. It is limited by K. It can be darker or it can be lighter. But in the second case, here the K value, what is there? It is a very fixed, very straight line. That means you'll be having only two values. It can be either dark or it can be light. But in the previous case, we had little values where it can be dark as well as light. Slowly it becomes to light. Suddenly it will not become to light. But in the second case, we have the thresholding. That means when we have a value, it is a fixed value. So it will be either dark or it will be light. So now coming to the basic intensity transformation functions. Actually, in this picture, we are having a combination of multiple transformations. You can see here, we are having the negative, we are having the log, we have the inverse log, we have the identity, and we have the power, all these things. Everything has been fitted to one particular range over here, one particular scale here. So what actually we are going to learn in this basic intensity transformation is, they are very simple techniques, and by using these simple techniques, we can go for transforming an image. So we know that we have the expression S is equal to T of R. So where T is a transformation that is going to map a pixel with value R into the pixel value S. So S is the output and R is the input. So because we are dealing with the digital quantities, the values of the transformation function, they are stored in a one-dimensional array, and the mappings from R to S are implemented via the lookup tables. So for a 8-bit environment, a lookup table will be consisting of 256 entries. So we are going to see some of the basic type of functions which are used frequently for the image enhancement. The first basic transformation is the image negative. So the image negative, it is the negative of an image with the intensity levels in the range 0 to L minus 1. So it is obtained by using the negative transformation like S is equal to L minus 1 minus R. So which is given, and then we are going to see this processing where it will be suited when we have a photographic negative. So in the photographic negative, you can see the line here, that line what is there, that is a negative. That means that when the value on the x-axis it is equal to 0, on the y value it will be equal to L minus 1. When the value on the x-axis it is equal to L minus 1, the value on the corresponding value on the y-axis will be equal to 0. So we are having the opposite, that is called as the image negatives. So this type of processing, it is suited for when we go for enhancing a white or a gray detail which is in the picture. That means when you have a dark region of a object, and you want to convert that to the light. And when the dark is very prominent over here and you want to look at some places which is not very dominant, then you can go for this particular image negative. So in this image negative, we can easily identify the opposite of the transformation. So in this image, you can see the picture where predominantly you are having a one particular color, that is the black color. So we have a lesion over here. That means we have some unwanted growth of the this one, unwanted growth. And if you want to look at this one, it is much easier when we convert this into a negative. So when you convert this into a negative, that you can see that easily we can identify the wound which is in this particular organ. So this this is taken as an example from a medical reports, and you can see that you can easily find out what is the lesion over here. That means if there is any wound or something, easily we can identify it. So this particular transformation which is going to help us in this is called as the negative transformation. You take an image and you negate it, it is very easy to identify the some parts of the image which are not very predominant. The next transformation is called as the gamma transformation. It can also be called as the power law transformation, where S will be equal to CR to the power of gamma, where C and gamma are the positive constants. So this equation can be simplified as where we have the epsilon also. So however, in this case, what we are going to do, the power law curves with the fractional values of gamma, they are going to map a narrow range of dark input values into a wider range of output values, with the opposite being true for the higher values of the input levels. So you can look at the curves over here. As the gamma is increasing, we can see the value of the gamma, it is equal to 1. And on the right hand side, it is increasing. On the left hand side, it is decreasing. So what is happening here? It is going to map a narrow range of dark input values into a wider range of output values. That means when we are having the on the x value, we are having the less value. On the y value, you can see here, it is having a range of big values. So it is going to map a narrow range of dark input values into a wider range of output values. And the opposite, that means when we have the narrow output values, it will become wider input values. So we can see that in this particular function, you can notice that a family of all the transformation curves, they can be obtained by varying gamma. So you can vary the gamma and you can go on get different values. So the curves which are generated with the values of gamma which is greater than 1 have exactly the opposite effect as that have been generated with the values less than 1. So we can see that it becomes an identity transformation when the C is equal to gamma is equal to 1. So a variety of devices which are used for the image capturing, printing and displaying, they make use of the power law transformation. So by convention, the power law equation is referred to as the gamma. That is why this response is called as the gamma correction. So even it is used in the CRT also, where we'll be having some gamma value set and you can go for the gamma correction and then you are going to get the output in a proper way. So this is one method what we are going to make use of in the image enhancement, and this is called as the power law transformation. This particular picture here, it is having different gamma values, and then based on the values we can see that the picture becomes more clear and clear. So the value of the gamma corresponding to these images, they are taken to be as 0.6, 0.4 and 0.3 respectively. So the first one is the original image. Okay, so we know that as the gamma value is decreasing from 0.6 to 0.3, we can see the more details are becoming visible. So if you increase further, little more details has become visible. So this is how the gamma is going to work. So we can't go any further. So then what will happen? The image will be deteriorated. By comparing all the results, we can see that the best enhancement in the terms of the contrast is obtained when the gamma value is equal to 0.4. So the gamma value of 0.3 is the approximation limit below which the contrast in this particular image will be reduced and it will not be accepted. So you can see that here we are having the MRI of a human spine. That human spine, when you give the gamma correction, when you go for the gamma value, So keeping the c value as 1, that is a constant, c value is equal to 1, and when you are going to vary, you will see that the picture becomes more clear as and when you are going to decrease the gamma value. But if you further decrease, it will not yield a good output. So we are going to stop at, so here we have another image. So this aerial image, you can see in the first image it is totally like washed out, it is fully very light color. So for this, when you are going to apply the gamma value by 3, 4 and 5, so you can see how the image is improving. But here also you can observe that at values 3 and 4, it is good. But after, when it goes to 5, the picture becomes very dark and some details are lost here. So the dark region to the left of the main road, you can see here in the upper quadrant where we are having, that road is not very clear in when you go for the 5 value. That means the values of the 3 and 4 is good, and when you go for the 5 and all, it is not very good. So this is an example where the gamma transformation, you can go for increasing also. With the gamma value, you can increase and you can enhance the image. In the previous case, we have seen how we can go for decreasing the gamma value and then go for enhancing the image. Both these are possible. You can go for enhancing the image in any of these two methods. The next transformation is the log transformation. For the log transformation, we are having the formula as S is equal to C log 1 plus R, where C is the constant, and we are going to assume that always R will be greater than or equal to 0. And then the shape of the curve here, it is going to show that the transformation is going to map a narrow range of low intensity values in the input to a wider range of output levels. So the opposite is true in the case of the higher values. We are going to use this transformation to expand the values of the dark pixels in an image while compressing the higher level values. So the opposite is true for the inverse log. Inverse log, we can go for the log as well as the inverse log. So the log function has an important characteristics that it is going to compress the dynamic range of the images with large variations in the pixel values. So in this case, you can see that by making use of the log transformations, we can go for expanding the values of the dark pixels in an image. But the difference between the gamma transformations and the log transformations is, there you can go for varying the gamma by simply varying the gamma. The gamma transformation is more simpler than the log transformation. As an illustration of the log transformations, here you can see this picture, which is showing a Fourier spectrum, and this Fourier spectrum, it is having the values in the range 0 to 1.5 into 10 to the power of 6. So when these values are scaled linearly for a display in an 8-bit system, the brightest pixels, they are going to dominate the display at the expense of the lower values of the spectrum. So the effect of this dominance, it is clearly illustrated here in the image. Whichever is not black, so that is nothing but the bright points. So we can go for using the value of C is equal to 1 here, and then the range of the values of the result will become from 0 to 6.2. So the figure here shows the result of scaling a new range linearly and displaying the spectrum in the 8-bit display. So most of the Fourier spectra which are going to be seen in the image processing publications and all, they have usually scaled by making use of this particular manner. That means by making use of the log transformation, we can go for. So a complementary approach to the methods discussed in the previous section is by making use of the piecewise linear transformation. The piecewise linear transformation, it can be in terms of the contrast stretching, or it can be a intensity level slicing. In the contrast stretching, it is very simple linear function, and this low contrast image can result from poor illumination, lack of dynamic range in the imaging sensor, or even the wrong setting of the lens aperture during image acquisition. So the contrast stretching is a process that is going to expand a range of intensity level in an image so that it is going to span the full intensity range of the recording medium or the display device. In this picture, we are having, first we will look at the first 3.11. In this image, the range between A and B. So whatever we are having the range between A and B, all of them will be, that is called as the range of interest. They will be having one value and everything else will be having another value. That means we will be having a binary image which will be produced after this particular contrast stretching. Okay. And in the second approach, what is going to happen? We are going to brighten the desired range of intensities and we are going to leave all other intensity levels in the image unchanged. That means from A to B, what is there, that we are going to increase the value. And everything else what is there, we are not going to bother about that. That means the all that intensities, they will remain unchanged. Whereas only for the images or only for the intensity values which are between the A and B in the image, for that one, we are going to brighten. We are going to increase the value. So this effect can be given to an image. That means we can select some part of the intensity and we can retain it. We can only for some intensity level, we can have a fixed value. Other intensities can be changed. So the first one, what we have here, it is nothing but it is producing a binary image. That means it can be either one value or another value. So that is called as a binary image. Whereas in the second case, we can have a range of values. But between A and B, we will be having one set of intensity level. Whereas for the other things, we are not going to change the values. So this effect, you can also look at when you go for a image below. What is this image below means? Here we have a kidney area. That means we are having a kidney area image. And this image has been enhanced over here. So this example, it is used for the intensity level slicing. That means we are going to highlight the major blood vessels that are appearing brighter as a result of the injected contrast medium. So in the first picture, you can see it is not very clear. The neighbors and all, it's not very clear. So but when you are going to make it a contrast medium, then you can see that you are going to apply the transformation. So with the selected band near the top of the scale, and then because of the range of the interest is brighter than the background, we can see the net result of this transformation is that the blood vessel and parts of the kidneys, they are going to appear white, while all other intensities, they are going to become black. This type of enhancement, it is going to produce a binary image, and it is useful for studying the shape of the flow of the contrast medium. That means if there is some blockage and all, easily we can identify. So this picture shows the result of using such a transformation in which a band of intensities in the mid-gray region around the mean intensity, it was set to black while all other intensities were left unchanged. That means we are concentrating on one part of the intensities and other part is unchanged. So here we can see that the gray level tone, whatever is there, of the blood vessels and part of the kidney area, they were left intact, but the other things are highlighted. So such a result, it is useful whenever we want to go for measuring the actual flow of the contrast medium as a function of the time in the series of images. The next type of processing, the transformation, is called as the bit plane slicing. So we know that whenever we are having a 8 bit of information, that is 1 byte of information, they can be arranged as different planes. So these pixels are nothing but the digital numbers. They are composed of bits. So the intensity of each pixel in this 256 gray level image, it will be consisting of 8 bits. So instead of highlighting the intensity level ranges, we can highlight the contribution of these particular bits, the total appearance by the specific bits. So in this picture, you can see here, we have a 8-bit image. It can be considered as being composed of 8 1-bit planes. So with the plane 1 containing the LSB of all the pixels and the plane 8 consisting of all the highest order MSBs. Decomposing one image into its bit planes is very useful for analyzing the relative importance of each bit in the image. A process that is going to aid us in determining the adequacy of the number of bits used to quantize the image. You can go for increasing or decreasing. You don't have to make use of all the bits. That is the idea over here. So this type of decomposition is useful for image compression. So because we are going to make use of less number of bits, so we'll be making use of this in the image compression, in which only some planes are used for reconstructing the image. You don't have to make use of all the information. So in this case, you can see in the example, this shows an image reconstructed using bit planes 8 and 7. The first A image, it is reconstructed by making use of the bit planes 8 and 7. The reconstruction is done by multiplying the pixels of the nth plane by the constant 2 to the power of n minus 1. This is nothing but it is going to convert the nth significant binary bit to decimal. So to obtain A, what we have done, we have multiplied the bit plane by bit plane 8 by 128, bit plane 7 by 64, and then we are going to add the two planes. So although the main features of this original image are restored, the reconstructed image, it is going to appear flat, especially in the background. So you can see it will not be like the original. Some deficiency will be there. So why it is happening? Because these two planes can produce only four distinct intensity levels. So when you're going to add the plane 6 to the reconstruction, that means when you go for the B, along with the 8 and the 7th plane, I'm going to add one more plane, that is the plane number 6. You can see that the picture becomes little more better. Okay, the picture becomes better because we are adding one more information, that is one more bit of information. So like this, when you're going to do, this effect is going to be, that means the advantage is going to be increasing when you go for the adding even the 5th plane also, that is being done in the figure C. So when you're going for the plane, bit plane 8, bit plane 7, bit plane 6 and 5, then you can see that the appearance of this image has become more better. So we can conclude that storing the 4th highest order bit planes will allow us to reconstruct the original image in the acceptable detail. So instead of storing the lower bit planes, I am storing only the upper bit planes. That means my image is going to require only 50% less storage in this case. That is that the histogram processing, it is a digital image with intensity. It is a digital image with intensity levels which are in the range 0 to L minus 1. So this is a discrete function h of rk which is equal to n of k. So histogram is a function. This function, it is a discrete value. It will be having discrete values. Hence it will be different values will be there. H of rk is equal to nk, where rk is the kth intensity value and nk is the number of pixels in the image with intensity rk. That means I am having many different intensity values from 0 to L minus 1. So this rk can be any intensity value and nk is the number of pixels which are in rk. That means if I am having an image which is having some colors, so each color is nothing but the intensity, and rk is nothing but it is going to give you the color, and nk will be the number of pixels which are of that color. So we will be having the h of rk is equal to nk, means where rk is equal to kth intensity value and the nk is the number of pixels in that intensity. So it is a common practice to go for normalizing a histogram where we are going to divide each of its components by the total number of pixels in the image, which are denoted by the product m into n. So we know that m and n are usually used for the number of rows and the number of columns in the image. Thus, a normalized histogram will be given by p of rk will be equal to rk by mn, where this k is equal to 0, 1, 2 up till L minus 1. So PRK is nothing but it is an estimate of the probability of the occurrence of the intensity level RK in an image. So the sum of all the components of a normalized histogram, it is equal to 1. PRK is equal. You can look at this image over here, which is for a pollen and which is having four basic intensity characteristics. The first one is dark, the second one is light, third one is low contrast, and the fourth one is the high contrast. So the right side of the figure, you can see that the histograms are corresponding to these images. The concentration of the colors, where it is, you can easily make out. The horizontal axis of each histogram is going to be plotted, which is corresponding to the intensity values of RK. And the vertical axis, they will be corresponding to H of RK, which is equal to NK, or P of RK is equal to RK by MN, if the values are normalized. So you can make out from this image that whenever we are having a dark image, the intensity values will be concentrated on the first half of the intensity value. That means all of them are lying on the darker shade. So if it is a lighter, so what we are going to produce here, I mean, what will be the output of the histogram processing is, this should be divided, that should be among all the ranges, it should be distributed. That we are going to achieve in the histogram processing. So in the histogram equalization, we can consider that, let us have the variable R, the intensity of the image. As usual, we'll assume that R is in the range 0 to L minus 1. With R is equal to 0 representing the black, that is extreme, and R is equal to L minus 1 is the white. For R satisfying these conditions, so it will be of the form S is equal to T of R, where 0 is less than or equal to R, which is less than or equal to L minus 1. This is going to produce an intensity level S for every pixel in the input image having the intensity R. Here we are going to have two assumptions. What is that one? The TR, that means the transformation of R, it is a monotonically increasing function in between the interval 0 to R less than or equal to L minus 1. And the second assumption is 0 is less than or equal to TR, which is less than or equal to L minus 1 for 0 less than or equal to R less than or equal to L minus 1. So here you have to observe, what is that one? S is the output, R is the input. So T of R is what? The transformation what we are going to apply on the input image. That is going to be monotonically increasing. That means it will be a curve which will be continuously increasing. And the transformation, it will be lying between the range 0 to L minus 1. The R is also going to lie between the range 0 to L minus 1. And then this TR, what is there, it is continuous and it will be differentiable. So the final, the fundamental result what we are going to get from the basic probability theory is that if the PR of R and the TR are known and the TR is continuous and it is differentiable over the range of values of the interest, then the probability distribution function of the transformed variable S, it can be obtained by using the simple formula, thus P of S of DS is equal to P of R of DR. So we see that the probability density function of the output intensity variable, yes, it is determined by the probability distribution function of the input intensities and the transformation function, which is used by making use of the R and S. So this is the equation for the histogram equalizing. In this figure 3.17, we can see that it is possible for having multiple values to map to a single value. And it can still satisfy these two conditions. That is, a monotonic transformation function performs a one-to-one or many-to-one mapping. So you can look at the A. So this A, it is presenting a problem where we want to recover the values of R, which are uniquely mapped from the values of the previous one. So this would be possible for the inverse mapping of SK. But the inverse mapping of SQ, it is in the range of R values. So the figure B, what is there? It is going to require that T of R is strictly monotonic. That means the inverse mappings will be single valued. This is a theoretical requirement which is going to allow us to derive some important histogram processing techniques which are going to be used later in this topic. One particular formula, that is the transformation function, it is very important in the image processing and it is having this form. What is that one? s is equal to t of r, which is equal to l minus 1, integration of 0 to r p of r w dw. So where we call this w, it is a dummy variable of integration. The right side of this equation, it is recognized as the CDF, that is the cumulative distribution function of random variable r. So we know that r is the input and s is the output. So on the right hand side, we are going to have, which is the cumulative distribution function. That means over a range of values, that is what is a range of values, l minus 1. So we are going to have the distributions over here. So because the PDFs are always positive, the probability distribution functions are always positive, and we can recall that the integral of the function is the area under the function. So it is going to follow that this particular equation s will be equal to tr, which will be equal to l minus 1 from 0 to r prw and dw. So this is a transformation equation. So to find the PS corresponding to the transformation we have discussed, we can make use of the next equation. So from the Leibniz rule in the basic calculus, we can go for deriving a definite integral with respect to its upper limit, and this upper limit is integrand evaluated at the limit. That is why ds by dr will be equal to dtr by dr, and we already know that this tr is given by the previous formula. So we are going to substitute that, and then we go for d by dr. So when you simplify this, it turns out that it will be equal to l minus 1 pr of r. So this, when you are going to substitute in dr by ds, and we are going to see that because all the probability values are positive, we are going to get this ps of s will be equal to pr of r dr by ds, which can also be written as pr of r 1 by l minus 1 into pr of r, where this s will be always lying between the range 0 to l minus 1. So this is called as the uniform probability distribution function. That means we can go for distributing the intensities uniformly when you go for a histogram processing. This histogram processing, what we are going to do, we are going to take the help of the equalization. That means we are going to go for distributing the colors uniformly and also improving the quality of the image. That type of processing is called as a histogram equalization. So the discrete form of the histogram equalization transformation, it will turn out to be where we have the sk value is equal to t of rk, which is equal to l minus 1 pr of w by w. So discrete values, when you are going to consider, that means it is not continuous. In the continuous, it will be equal to 0 to r, where we have the integration. So this can also be written as a discrete value formula. So when you go for discrete value formula, you can see that sk will be equal to t of rk. So in the previous case, we don't have any rk and all, because we are not having any discrete values. We are not stopping. It is continuous. In this one, this is the discrete value. Sk will be equal to t of rk. And this value, this formula, we are going to make use of in the next problem, so that it will be clear to you how we can go for histogram equalization. That means the intensity, what is there? That intensity is going to be distributed among l minus 1. Whatever the intensities we have, when we sum up everything together, we are going to get the total image intensity. Whereas when you are going for a discrete value, you are going to distribute them among different levels. Here we didn't have the s naught value at all. That s naught value here, what we had, it is not at all there. It is only equal to 1. That means we are coming to the intensity 1 and we are not coming to the intensity 0. So here we will not have any 0 value. We will not have any 0, this 0 range what is there. It won't be there at all. But in the second one, you are having value as 1. This value 1, it will be equal to 0.19. That means what we had in the previous value, that is we had this PR of RK, which is equal to 0.19. For the 3, we are having the value here. The 3, you can look at the 3 value, it is equal to 0.16. But the 3 is also present in another value, which is called as the 3.08. So this 3 value, the S of 3, it will be having its value as 6 over here, and we are having this value as 0.03. So this 0.03 is given by 3. So for the 7, what we have, you can look at the 7 here. The 7 is given by 5, 6 and 7. For the 5, 6 and 7, you can see the values here. It is equal to 0.06, 0.03, 0.02. Totally it comes to 0.11. That is why this 7 will be equal to 0.11. For the 6, we are having 0.11. In this case, we are having the value as 0.03, and for the 6, it is also added with the S3 and S4. So in the S3, what we had 0.16, in the S4, what we had 0.08. So totally, it will come to 0.24. So that value is represented as 0.24. And now this will be the equalized histogram. So this is how we are going for the histogram equalization. So you can look at this picture over here. In the first picture, the dark image what was there, and now we are having the image which is equalized. We can see that the pattern here, it is become uniform. That means the distribution of the color has become uniform. So when you equalize an image which is very dark, or which is very light, or which is having not having very good contrast, or which is having good contrast, all these images what are there, now they are brought down to a image which will be equalized, and I am going to get a equalized histogram. This is the output of the histogram equalization. This histogram equalization is significant for enhancing an image. Thank you.